So good morning, afternoon, and evening, as the case may be. And welcome to our friends across the nation and around the world. My name is Eugene Rule, and I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker today. And I won't give you my usual spiel about how much we respect the work of Karl Marx and each other, and how we want to change the world and not just talk about it. Instead, I want to announce a really good piece of news I just learned about on Friday about one of our speakers who won a very important court case. And this is Lillian House, who spoke last year on October 25th on the police attack on anti-racist organizers in Aurora, Colorado, a suburb of Denver. And she was one of the leaders of demonstrating against the police killing of Elijah McClain in Aurora, Colorado. His story is all too familiar here in the United States. Lillian was only 26 years old, but she and her equally youthful comrades in the Party for Liberation and Socialism were facing a lifetime in prison on totally bogus charges of inciting a riot and kidnapping the entire Aurora Police Department. It turns out that this was too much even for a Colorado judge. And we just learned that these charges were thrown out of court, leaving the DA pretty confused about what to do next. And so I'm very proud of Lillian and her young comrades, and also about our institute, the way we handled this, especially Alan, who set the whole thing up. Alan on our tech team. And this, to my mind, exemplifies who we are and what we do. Now, our speaker today also exemplifies our work. K.J.Noh is a scholar, educator, and activist, journalist, focusing on the geopolitics of the Asia Pacific. He writes for Dissident Voice, Black Agenda Report, Counterpunch, Popular Resistance, Asia Times, and is a senior correspondent for the KPFA Flashpoints. He also does commentary and analyzes various shows. And he's a contributor to the book, Capitalism on a Ventilator, analyzing the capitalist response to the COVID-19 pandemic. It's banned from Amazon.com, but available from respectable book dealers. And I know, known KJ for over 10 years, ever since I escaped from my 30-year exile in Southern California and returned to my native Bay Area. And I've benefited from numerous conversations with him, and he's become kind of like my go-to man when I get confused about what's going on in Asia. And I am very confused about what's going on in Myanmar. So I'm very happy that KJ has accepted our invitation and is here today with us. So I want to turn things over to you, remind everybody that everyone is muted and hold your questions. KJ will be speaking for about 45 minutes to an hour, and then we'll move on to our Q&A. Is that right, KJ?
Sounds good.
Okay, sounding good. So over to you.
Thank you, Gene. I'm really honored and happy to be able to do this presentation. As you know, there has been a coup in Myanmar. It was on February 1st. And since then, developments have been happening in a very confusing, but also very deadly direction. So I think it's useful for us to have a look both at what is happening on the ground, but also to look at some of the history and some of the material and cultural forces involved. So I'll just start out by pointing out the obvious. We know that there is a massive protest movement against the military coup. This has been covered extensively in the mainstream press.
KJ?
Yes.
Go ahead. I thought we lost you. Sorry.
Yes. And then, of course, Myanmar, which is, for for most of its modern period has been a military dictatorship. Starting around 2010, it had a power sharing agreement with the civilian government, but this was a very precarious and tentative power sharing agreement. The military held on to 25% of the legislative seats by fiat, and they also had control of key ministries, in particular the interior ministry, the border ministry, and the department and the military. And so it's really a kind of a military cohabitation rather than any civilian government in a traditional sense. What this has resulted in is mass repression by the military against the protests. Yesterday was probably the worst slaughter since the coup. 114 people were killed yesterday, and this comes on the tail of two other days where, you know, people were killed in the dozens and scores. So you can see that there's a tremendous escalation of violence. I have always predicted right from the get-go that, you know, this was in the works. Now, there are other elements of this which we also have to understand, is that there are elements where we can see clearly that there's foreign intervention. If you look here, that is a symbol of Aung San Suu Kyi, and these are protesters asking for the return of Aung San Suu Kyi. But you can see that she's backgrounded against a rising sun. So if you know anything about Myanmar's history, you'd also understand that the Japanese colonized Myanmar and killed off about 250,000 at least of its people. So it would be a very odd thing to see the rising sun behind a genuinely national protest movement. Now, the rising sun or elements of it still exist in the Karen National Army insignia. So I will get to that later. But all this to say is that there are many forces at play in the current moment. We're also seeing more indigenous and more grassroots revolts in the countryside. This is a more recent phenomena. Prior to the more recent developments, most of the protests were in the cities, and they were largely involved English-speaking banners, which is, once again, Burma is a country where 5% of the population speak English, and it's, you know, it would be an odd thing in under most circumstances. So these are indigenous movements happening across Burma. And then you see here, that insignia is the KNU, the Karen National Liberation Army. And they are actually supporting the demonstrators in the Karen areas. And so what we have to understand is this current coup and the protests and the slaughter has to be understood within the context of civil war between over 20 ethnic minorities, the Tatmadaw, the Burmese military, the NLD, which is the current Bama majority civilian government. We also have to note that this is the longest civil war in the modern era, certainly in the post-World War II era. And we can't understand without understanding the history. So the key point to understand is Burma was a British colony. And unlike most British colonies, the British ruled Burma directly as a military bureaucratic dictatorship. This is because the Burmese fought the British for decades. And as a result of this, the British actually had to impose a complete top-down military occupation in Burma. As they did this, as they do almost everywhere else, they also created an ethnicity-based hierarchy with select non-Burmese minorities as intermediary strata. At the current point, there are some, you know, there are dozens of, there are actually 135 ethnic groups, but they can be grouped into probably a score of larger ethnic groupings, and their states and the armed ethnic organizations. There are about 20 of them, along with hundreds, possibly over 1,000 militias. Some of these armed ethnic organizations are very powerful. They have their own internal economies, and they're very, very important players in the current situation. So once again, the key thing to understand is Burma is a chimeric, artificially constructed state created by the British from over 135 distinct ethnic groups. The British fought two wars, and they brutally colonized the area, and they instituted a military bureaucratic occupation. The British and the Europeans, of course, were at the top. The Indian, who were immigrants, and the Christianized minorities were in an intermediate control strata, and the Buddhist minorities and the Bama were placed at the bottom. Originally, when the British controlled Burma, they controlled the plains directly as part of the British Indian Empire. But the hill areas in the north and to the east were Christianized. They turned into Catholics and Methodists, and they were given relative autonomy. The hill ethnicities were also used to discipline and control the region and quash rebellion for the Bamas, which was an ongoing process. It lasted for decades. And among these ethnicities, the Karen were especially important. The other factor is that there was massive immigration into Burma at the time from India, and this created an even more multi-ethnic state. The founder of Burma is Aung San, and he co-founded the Communist Party of Burma, served as its Secretary General. He had originally attempted to get Chinese communist support for an independent Burma, and he traveled to Xiamen, but Xiamen had been taken over by the Japanese, and the Japanese were able to persuade him to work with them. They helped support and built the Burmese Independence Army, which actually fought against the British and liberated, quote unquote, the Burmese from the British. The problem with that is anyone, again, who knows the history of the Japanese Empire, was that this was really kind of a fraudulent independence, and that essentially it was trying to turn Burma into a vassal state of the Japanese Empire. And the Burmese themselves, Aung San's lieutenant, said that if the British sucked our blood, the Japanese ground our bones. So the Aung San and the Burmese Independence Army then turned and fought against the Japanese. He formed the Anti-Fascist People's Freedom League, fought the Japanese, and then negotiated independence from the United Kingdom. So this is a picture of Clement Attlee, the Prime Minister of the UK, and Aung San. So after World War II and the surrender of Japan, the British reclaimed the colony, but they did not want to, they didn't want to return Burma, but they were overstretched and exhausted. Essentially, the British Empire was on its last legs, and they were concentrating in the region on trying to retain Malaya, which was Malaya at the time, and that turned into a massive genocidal insurgency. Churchill himself actually wanted to keep Burma. He did not want to give it up. But Attlee, who was, you know, the Labour Party prime minister, was willing to consider independence. Aung San had strong communist and anti-imperialist tendencies. So he worked with the Shan states through the Panglong Conference. This is kind of a confederated agreement. And with the Chin, Kachin, Karenni, and Shan, they agreed to a confederated union with the option to secede after 10 years. And this allowed them to formulate a plan for independence that was presented to the British. Attlee agreed to this, but the conservative factions in the British government actually opposed this, and they were worried that Aung San, who was a communist, was going to, you know, extend communism in Burma. But anyway, Attlee agreed to this, and the die looked as if it had been cast. This is a picture of the Panglong Conference. You can see all the, you can see the ethnic minority groups and Aung San meeting. So after the Panglong Agreement, the Constituent Assembly elections were held in 1947, but Aung San was assassinated not long after the election by the former prime minister under the British colonial system. And then war broke out right after independence in Karen State. And it's widely suspected that the British were behind or certainly supporters of the rebellion, and they may have been involved in the assassination of Aung San. So the promises of autonomy, self-determination, and equality were broken. And since then, Burma has been the world's longest running continuous civil war. It's essentially a country of warring states. That's our Winston Churchill, who is, I think, bears a very, very strong responsibility for the debacle that Burma is in right now. The Panglong Conference agreement said that save as expressly provided in this constitution or in any act of parliament, every state shall have the right to secede from the union in accordance with the conditions hereinafter prescribed, essentially within 10 years if they are not satisfied. Now, the Rakhine actually did not join the Panglong Conference, and neither did the Mon. So they create a separate set of issues as the history moves forward. So we know that the separatist rebellion with the Karen started in 1948-1949. The British were smuggling guns to the Karen. And the actual weapons that Usaw, the former prime minister, used to assassinate Aung San were actually given to him by the British. So clearly the British were thick in it. As the Karen rebelled, the Mon also rebelled because they had never been part of the Panglong Conference. And then the Muslims in Rakhine also rose up. Then the Karenni rose up. And then there was a Catholic and Baptist split. The Karenni had been Christianized, but there was a split within themselves. And then the Kachin rebelled against the declaration of Buddhism as a state religion by the Burmese government. In the 1960s, the Shan and the Chin rebelled, in particular the Shan, who had been funded by the CIA and who had been working with the Kuomintang. So essentially what we're looking at is a civil war with 20 plus ethnic groups, the longest civil war in the modern era. And to understand the map of the situation, we have to understand the different ethnic groups and their armed ethnic organization. their armies. So as you can see, here are some of the key ethnic groups. There's the Bama majority, there's Shan, Karen, Rakhine, Rohingya, the Kachin, the Chin, Kareni, Mon, Wa, Kokang, Chinese, as well as what are grouped as the Shan. Again, here's another picture. You can see the Chin, the Rohingya, the Rakhine, who are both in Rakhine State, the Karen, the Kareni, the Mon, the Shan, the Wa, the Kachin. The Wa actually have an independent state. They've been legally granted an autonomous state. Here's the other map, which is also important, is that you can see that there are major conflicts happening all across Burma and in all the, almost all the ethnic states. And this is the larger context that we have to understand within this current protest. There's been ongoing, massive bloodshed all around Burma. It did not start with the Rohingya. So if your history of ethnic repression in Rakhine State, in Burma starts with the Rohingya, you know, you are several million too late and several decades, you know, too late. Kachin State has been at war since 1961. We estimate there are probably 150,000 refugees and IDPs. They are currently allies with the Arakan Army in Rakhine State. They had a ceasefire for 17 years from 1994 to 2011. And David Brenner, who is a good scholar of Myanmar, refers to it as a kind of ceasefire capitalism, which was an extractive, collaborative, corrupt system between the leadership of Kachin State and the Burmese capitalists. So the jade, there's a lot of jade in Burma. The jade mountains were emptied, the teak forests were decimated, and then there was massive drug addiction, and the women, the daughters were trafficked. So eventually this became so horrendous that the Kachin took up arms again in 2011. Currently 10% are IDPs, internally displaced peoples, and they are fighting for their existence. They're currently opposed to the coup. The Shan State is also opposed to the coup, or various factions of the Shan State are opposed to the coup. They've been at war since 1958. They fought with the Kuomintang, but also against the Kuomintang at various points. The Shan State Army was in overt warfare from 1964 to 1976, then it split into the Shan State Army North, and then later into the Shan State Army South. And we estimate between 5,000 to 8,000 troops. There is a self-administered zone in Shan State, the Kokang SAZ. They've been at war since 1989. 30,000 refugees escaped to Yunnan, China. We have the Wa State. The Wa State is actually a self-administered autonomous district within the Shan State. They have their own army. And then we also have the Kareni, the Kaya State, which also has its own army. It's a smaller military, probably about 1,500 troops. And we estimate about 27 to 30,000 IDPs. Now, the Karen are probably one of the most important groups at the current moment. They were not actually a homogenous grouping until they were Christianized by the West. And they formed an important force in the Anglo-Burmese wars that lasted over 60 years. And they were used to control and pacify the country during British rule. They broke out into open warfare in 1949. We estimate there are about 200,000 refugees that are Karen, and they have undergone massive ethnic cleansing, but they've also been fighting back in open warfare. There are different evaluations of the KNU, the Karen National Union, of which the Karen Army is the military arm. Some scholars see them as essentially a corrupt ethno-nationalist warlord with their corrupt patronage and the kind of ceasefire capitalism, extractive capitalism. And on the other hand, there's also an element that sees them as revolutionary saviors against the Burmese military oppression. There are differences between the hills and the lowlands. And also, we understand that the elite leaders don't always bring on the grassroots. There was even a split of the Karen army, which split off into Buddhists. The Karen are largely a Christian, but the Buddhists split off, joined the Burmese, and then defected from them again. And then, of course, there's the Arakan army, AA, in Rakhine State. And these are one of the most, they are one of the most formidable armies, probably in the range of 30 to 100,000 troops. There's also the Arakan Liberation Army, which is smaller, and ARSA, which is the ISIS-influenced or connected Muslim army in Rakhine State. We all know about the 750,000 Rohingya who were ethnically cleansed and escaped as refugees, but very few people know about the 200,000 Rakhine refugees. There was a ceasefire agreement in 2010, but that has actually been, it's no longer. The 10 signatories of the ceasefire agreement have said that they support the civil disobedience movement, the protest movement against the coup, and they will not engage in a peace dialogue with the military regime. The KNU has been very vocal, and the Karen National Liberation Army has been aiding civilian protesters in its areas of control. The other important armed ethnic organization is the Kachin Independence Organization. They support the People's Resistance and they oppose the coup. The Committee for Shan State Unity, which represents multiple Shan ethnic armed groups, has also opposed the coup. So you can see here, this is the Kachin military, and they're actually supporting the protesters. This is another image of the Kachin. They've actually, this is a Burmese army camp that they have attacked, and they have taken the Tatmadaw captive. The Myanmar military has actually been taken captive here. Now, to make this even more complex, there are other combatants, the Australian SAS, the British SAS, the French Foreign Legion. They've all been involved overtly in the war, and some of them have been members of, for example, the Karen Army. The US Green Berets have been involved, and certainly the CIA was supporting the KMT at an earlier point in time. The arms are flowing in from China, India, Israel, North Korea, the Philippines, Russia, Ukraine, US, and Thailand. And of course, there are various factions that are foreign supporters. So there's some element of what's going on, which is similar to the ethno-nationalist liberation movements that we see with the FARC, the Naxalites, the Moro, the Kurds, the Tuareg. And we can note that they're all practicing a kind of asymmetric warfare, which is to say that they're Maoists in practice, if not in ideology. But the key fact is that Aung San Suu Kyi, who led the civilian government, disappointed them. She locked all the ethnic groups out of the political process and actually exacerbated and escalated repression of the ethnic groups. Most notably, we know that for the Rohingya, but certainly for the Rakhine and the Arakan army, they were declared terrorists and they had a what they call the four no's, no food, no information, no recruitment, no funding, essentially no quarter. So they had a policy of ethnic cleansing and genocide towards the Buddhist Rakhine as well as all towards all of the ethnic groups that had not actually signed this weak ceasefire agreement. That itself has now fallen apart. Now, the other thing to understand is that the Kachin and the Karen are heterogeneous movements and they're very fragile groupings. But the key thing to understand is that there is a large majority of citizens from many groups, including mostly the Bama majority, but also many ethnic groups that are protesting the coup. The business owning class and the elites are standing by, waiting to align themselves with the eventual victors. The ethnic minorities have shifting and complex allegiances because on the one hand, they see the NLD, the majority Bama civilian government, as repressive as the Burmese military. They say, you know, it's one dictatorship or the other. But at the same time, there seems to be a shift towards opposing the coup, but not necessarily supporting the deposed NLD. And the discussion is about dismantling the 2008 constitution, which was put into place by the military and is essentially a military dominated constitution with the trappings of a civilian government. The business class have kept a very low profile. The elites have kept a low profile. And as I mentioned earlier, the 3rd, the 14th, and yesterday were the bloodiest days since the coup was staged. The Burmese and the ethnic minorities have vowed to continue protesting. To make this issue even more larger, if we pan out, we have to understand that US is escalating towards a shooting war with China and there are monstrous lies being spread, the most notably about slave labor in Xinjiang district and genocide. These are verifiably false. There's, you know, it's a genocide. If it's a genocide, it's the strangest genocide on the planet with the population increasing massively and wealth increasing massively, and nobody can point to a single body. But anyway, these lies are being spread because the US is engaged in multi-domain hybrid warfare with China, essentially because they see China as a threat to the US-led neoliberal order. So this hybrid warfare involves economic warfare, tech warfare, legal warfare, diplomatic warfare, military brinksmanship, civil subversion, including the color revolution that we saw in Hong Kong, and also the attempts to destabilize using Islamic terrorism in Xinjiang, as well as academic warfare. But the key element of this is information warfare. So Chinese human rights abuses, Chinese concentration camps, Chinese COVID, genocide in Xinjiang, et cetera, et cetera. Now, that context has to be understood with the Pacific pivot. In 2000, up to 2008, the US had this tentative, precarious coexistence, détente with China. because it was assuming that China would do one of two things. It would collapse of its own internal contradictions, like the Soviet Union, or it would become totally capitalist and become part of the US-led, US-controlled, US-dominated neo-colonial order as a vassal capitalist state. That didn't happen. What happened instead was in 2008, the US financial and the global financial system collapsed while China stood strong. And what became very clear was that China was not going to collapse of its own accord, but actually needed to be taken down. And so this is when the preparations for what we call the pivot to Asia started, essentially an encirclement of China with 400 bases, and then the escalation towards a massive hybrid war against China on all fronts. This was done by the Obama administration. It was officially declared in 2011, but preparations started around 2008. The architect of this was actually Kurt Campbell, who holds the China portfolio in the Biden administration right now. Part of this encirclement of China involved something called air-sea battle, which is essentially the war doctrine against China. So you can see this is the force allocation right around China. But this is the key map that you have to understand. This is the Malacca Strait. You can see it's a tiny, tiny, narrow strait. And then you can see this is the South China Sea. $5.3 trillion worth of goods travels through the South China Sea. And 70% of China's oil travels through the South China Sea. And the war doctrine, air-sea battle, envisages that the United States, all it has to do is engage in a shooting war against China. And the disruption to shipping will essentially shut down China's economy and bring it to its knees within months. So that's the war doctrine. The US doesn't actually have to win the war. All it needs to do is start a war. And just as we saw with the disruption with a tanker, a single tanker in the Suez Canal is creating huge ripple effects right now. To have a literal war in the South China Sea would be one of the key ways to bring China down. The Chinese response starting 2013, remember air-sea battle was started in 2008, declared around 2010, 2011. Pacific pivot was declared in 2011. Starting around 2013, the Chinese started to militarize some of the artificial islands in the South China Sea to raise the costs of military intervention for the United States. So that was their first response, but really the second response is much more important. And this is what we call the Belt and Road. So the Belt and Road is an overland escape route from this sea-based encirclement along the first island chain. And if you see, there's a part of this which goes right through Myanmar. This is called the CMEC, or the China-Myanmar Economic Corridor. It reaches out to the Kyakfu port, going through Rakhine State, all the way from Yunnan to Rakhine State, where there are already multiple pipelines. It goes out to the deep sea port, and that takes it immediately out into the Bay of Bengal, which then can go to Africa and the Persian Gulf. So this is why Myanmar is also important geostrategically and geopolitically. And also why there is such a denunciation or an attempt to tar China with the military coup. The Chinese had actually inked 33 deals with the NLD, the civilian government, last year. Xi Jinping visited Myanmar last year, and they were in the process of really consolidating the Belt and Road when this coup happened earlier this year. the US and what we call the Milk Tea Alliance. This is a grouping of right-wing reactionary color revolutionaries supported by the United States in Thailand and Taiwan and Hong Kong are trying to label this or blame the coup on the Chinese. But actually the Chinese have relationships with the military, with the ethnic armed organizations, as well as with the NLD. In fact, probably the closest relations were with the NLD. The military itself looks to be soliciting US help, and they're making the argument that they felt that one of the reasons for the coup was that the NLD was too close to the Chinese. We don't know if that's true, but that's the current lobbying that they're making right now. And you can see that the US is both denouncing Myanmar, but also standing back and waiting to see if it can leverage this coup against Chinese projects along of the Belt and Road. The other thing is that the US is also does have a hand. It sunk millions of dollars into CSOs inside of Myanmar during this short civilian period. And CSOs function essentially like a top-down shadow government. They're funded by US government sources or related NGO funding. And they create a kind of shadow government. And you can see that they've had a fairly large hand in the opposition to the coup. At the same time, the military also saw that when Aung San Suu Kyi, who really had been groomed and cultivated by the West to tighten her relationships with the United States and the West, when they took her down, she was this kind of, saint of democracy. But when they took her down, the military saw its opportunity to reclaim its power. The other piece, which is also important to remember, is the military claimed that there was massive vote fraud. And of course, the mainstream media is saying that there was none or it was not significant. But that is not the key issue. It wasn't vote fraud on the day of the voting, but it was massive voter disenfranchisement. Probably between 1.5 million to 2.5 million voters were disenfranchised leading up to the November elections. And almost all of them were in ethnic minority cantons. I think 56 or 57 ethnic minority cantons essentially had voting stopped on the pretext that, there was an armed conflict going on. But actually, there was voting that went on across the board, and, that the armed conflicts have not prevented voting prior to this. And so it was largely seen as a pretext by the NLD to disenfranchise the ethnic minorities, which were not favorably disposed to the NLD. So all of this is to say is that currently there is a coup. The military used the elections as a way to kind of clip the wings of the NLD. They had sent prior to the elections themselves 23 official letters to the civilian government asking them to look into allegations of vote fraud. And the NLD civilian government just ignored them completely. And that's a very bad thing to do. The military doesn't take kindly to being disrespected in such a blatant and obvious manner. And clearly the civilian NLD government overplayed their hand. They did two things. One is they assumed that they had, massive support when actually their support was quite fragile, certainly among the ethnic communities. They had already lost lots of Western support because of Aung San Suu Kyi's collaboration with the military itself during the Rohingya massacres, but also other massacres. And of course, Aung San Suu Kyi herself who is the daughter of Aung San, the founder of Burma and the Burmese military, believed that she could hold the military close to her chest and actually not only befriend and tame them, but actually take power away from them. That was a serious miscalculation. So currently, this is the state we're in. The country is in a horrific state. There's mass slaughter, massive civil resistance, massive strikes. At the current moment, you could say that, you know, the resistance is in quote unquote a heroic mode. But if you know anything about insurgencies and protests, this eventually tends to exhaust itself, especially as if you go on strike, strikes are useful for a short period of time. Banks and the government offices are on strike, as well as certain key sectors. But also, if you strike, you also undermine, you know, the country's functioning, which then, over the long term, affects the ability of the people, the citizen general, to resist at all. And currently, 63% of Myanmar's population has been driven under the $2 a day poverty line. So that's 63% of the population, probably more, living on less than $1.90 a day. And in the middle of a coup, and in the middle of a, you know, massive chaos and civil resistance, with multiple factions vying in different directions. There are elements of the ethnic minorities that have joined with the military. There are others that have refused, most notably the Kachin, the Karen, and the Shan. But this is still an evolving situation. I think it would be very, very foolish for anybody to make clear predictions on what will happen next. We have to watch the situation very, very carefully. But at the current moment, it is a crossfire hurricane and a massive tragedy. And with multiple forces, both geopolitical and internal and historical, vying for, you know, vying to control the state. I think I'll stop there. And Gene, what is our time?
Okay, well, we're in good shape. And thank you very much. This was, I'm glad this was recorded, because I, for one, am going to have to watch it again to clarify my thinking on all this. But our next step is we're going to take a very short break for a few announcements, and then we're going to go to Q&A. And I think you'll all be muted for the Q&A, and I will keep the stack and notify people when their two minutes is up, and when you get a notification from me. Try to end as quickly as possible, because we do have a virtual hook to pull you off stage. So with that, let me just say, first of all, next week, we're still working on our program. We have a couple of possibilities, and the situation is still rather fluid, but we will be able to get that up on our webpage, hopefully by Wednesday or Thursday. So we will have a program next week. It'll be very interesting. The speaker will probably be from India. We're not sure if it's going to be Raj or one of his friends from India, but we'll announce that later. And also, Richard, do you want to say something about our finances?
Yes, thank you, Gene. We're still collecting money for the ICSS and for the Marxist Library in Oakland. I put up a details on the chat about how you can send money through PayPal or checks. I just mentioned that we'll probably soon be able to receive money through Patreon, but we'll give you details later. But at any rate, urge anybody who hasn't given for a while or hasn't given at all to send a few bucks our way. And I think it'll be very useful to promote these very valuable programs. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you, Richard, and thanks to our crew for handling the mechanics of all this. And everybody is muted, but if people will start raising their hands, we can start going through a stack, and I will keep the stack and notify people at the 2-minute limit. So hopefully I've got my iPhone's here somewhere. But I see Yusuf has his hand up. So Yusuf, go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. Your talk provide great clarity on China, but it made me a little confused in terms of Burma. For me, the good guys are the anti-imperialist guys, not necessarily every ethnic minority, not necessarily every one who raises against corruption or democracy. I am for, you know, socialism, but state capitalism will do. And well, if there's some corruption and a lack of democracy, I think I've come to the stage that we should be tolerated. The worst is laissez-faire capitalism. Now, in terms of an analysis directed towards people like me, could you sort of re-summarize the situation in Burma? Because I'm very suspicious of this democracy movement, because just about every democracy, well, in Turkey, the democracy movement is generally the good guys. I happen to know it, but and the government is laissez-faire, but a democracy movement against a state capitalist movement, and Burma has a strong, I understand, state capitalist, they call it Burmese socialism tradition. So I'm very suspicious of the democracy movement in Burma. So could you sort of summarize Burma in that perspective?
KJ, do you want to respond to these individuals who go through? Okay, so you need to unmute yourself, I think.
So, you know, this is a really good question. And I think the first point I would make is that Burma used to be socialist. It had what they called the Burmese way to socialism. And of course, remember that Aung San himself was a communist, or at least a Marxist. In Marxist anti-imperialist. The Burmese had a kind of indigenous socialism, but it was also a garrison state. Starting around 1988, they shifted to a different kind of economy, political economy, which was, a colleague says that it was essentially crypto capitalist. It was essentially a capitalist extractive economy. And we see that most in the kind of industries that it was involved in. Most of the gems, especially, you know, things like rubies, tanzanite, jade, the really, really expensive precious stones, as well as other rare earth metals. A lot of this is extracted out of Burma. And then also along the border states, there is a massive industry, both in arms and also in the production of methamphetamine. So all of this is to say is that it is not a single unified economy by any stretch of the imagination. There are large pockets of the political economy that are autonomous and quasi-legal. And then the other aspect is that the socialism that we thought of was essentially dismantled. Certainly under the civilian government, but even prior to then, the military itself was drifting away from any notion of a state-guided socialism. That isn't to say the military doesn't control large sectors of the economy, but I would say that it's more like Egypt than it is like, for example, North Korea or even China.
Okay, thank you. Next speaker is Mohan here, and then we don't have anybody after that. So please raise your hand, get on the stack.
Who owns the national resources right now? Because my understanding is that the economy of Burma or Myanmar is mostly based upon simply extracting natural resources and routing it out, and there's not much of other industries. So what's the nature of the ownership of these?
Large sections of the economy are held by the military, but also there are extractive business elites that have connections with other, you know, multinational forces, and they're also holding large parts of the economy. So certainly it's not the, you know, the image of socialism that we are thinking. As I said, it's a kind of crypto capitalism with a small overlay or small veneer of, you know, socialist, you know, language. That said, you know, I remind people that in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, you know, Burma was still considered one of the models of development. You know, those of us, you know, who, you know, go back that far, remember that there was a book called Small is Beautiful. I don't know if people recall that book. That was actually about, yes, this was actually about Burma's development. But since then, the country, you know, has deviated long and far, and really the large part of it is extractive capitalism, particularly you know, mining of precious gemstones, jade, and some of the really most expensive gems that you can think of, as well as the extraction of rare earth metals. There's also teak. Teak is also a very large part of this extractive industry.
A quick follow-up to that is, has this ownership and has the way in which the economy has run, has it changed at all in between the so-called takeover of the democratic government of Aung San Suu Kyi and others, or and when things have changed, or is it that nothing has changed, it's just the face out there?
I think the system was remaining the same. I think the collaborations were changing. I think there was more foreign investment. The civilian government opened up the space for a more, you know, gave the, you know, cover for foreign investment to come in, whereas before it was largely, remember, Burma was one of the most sanctioned states in the world. It was like North Korea. And when the government transitioned to a civilian economy, this allowed other, you know, extractive global corporations to come in, for example, oil corporation. So I think the structure is the same, but there's simply more collaboration and more neoliberal globalized extraction going on.
Okay, let's move back to Yusuf, and then we'll go to Sharon. So we have 2 minutes again. Yusuf and then Sharon. Or let's move to Sharon. Sharon, go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, just a minute. Okay.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Yes. Well, I just briefly. So I agree that also the government of Belarus dismantled much of the state or economy, but the opposition was really for dismantling more. In Ukraine, same thing. The new regime is much further to the right. And also, I might add in Syria, Assad was a sort of a liberalization as a privatization, but the opposition is clearly for even more. And so Assad now, would I be right that sort of that the military, albeit that it has, it's not the Ne Win regime, it is still preserving some ghost of it, whereas the opposition wants to dismantle it completely. Would that be correct?
Yes and no. I mean, I think it's a mistake to think of the opposition as a single force. There are many, many factions within it, and they have many, many different goals. There's clearly the NLD-aligned opposition, which is really about putting the NLD back into power. And remember, the NLD is not the saviors that the Western press has made them out to be. They've been extraordinarily dictatorial towards many of the ethnic minorities. So the NLD would like to regain its power. And there are factions that support that. There are factions that do not support that. There are also, factions that simply want an end to military rule. They see this as an opportunity to end the military rule that has been in place since 1968. They see it as an opportunity to roll back the 2008 constitution and to try and create a confederated state, which was originally the plan of the Panglong agreement. Right now, the NLD has morphed, and from declaring all of the armed ethnic organizations as terrorists, which is how they had branded them under the regime of Aung San Suu Kyi, now they have, are trying to make nice, and they've actually appointed their vice president of this civilian shadow government. They've appointed, if I'm not mistaken, a Karen. So anyway, all of this to say is that it's not a simple binary. And if we think of it in terms of simple binaries, I think we're going to get misled. I think we're going to underestimate the situation. And we're also not going to be able to make any meaningful predictions.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We're going to move to our list again. We got some people on the stack. First, we have Sharon, then we have Ann Lewis, then we have John Walsh, and then we have Mehmet. So, and we've got 2 minutes each. So go ahead, Sharon.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this presentation. And in particular, thank you for explaining the role that Myanmar plays in the Belt and Road Initiative. That was very helpful. But I would like to understand more about in whose interest the military is doing what it's doing. It's hard for me to figure out. It seems like they don't represent a class in and of themselves, the military. But so in whose class interests are they working? Part of capital, I guess, international capital maybe. Can you talk about that a little more?
You know, there are different theories and nobody has the definitive answer in my opinion. But I think the simplest and most reductive answer is to say that the military is working in its own interest. There's one theory, which is simply that the military got fed up with the humiliation by the NLD. If you hold the levers of power, but the civilian government refuses to even meet or respond to you on the most basic level regarding what they consider to be legitimate objections to a very, very corrupted electoral process, then, you know, the people with the arms are going to step back and show who's boss, because, you know, it's like cohabitating with your room, with your landlord. You know, you share the apartment, but your roommate is your landlord. At a certain point, if you piss them off too much, they're going to show you that they are still the landlord. So that's one piece of it. Another theory is that General Min, who is the leader of this military coup, of the army itself, was trying to secure his political future. He was slated to retire soon. And so he wanted to secure his a political future inside the civilian political system. And when that didn't go his way, then he saw, you know, the utility of doing this coup. There's also the viewpoint, you know, that there are multiple factions involved, multiple corporate interests involved, but those kind of break down, and it's not, there's no clear direction, because the NLD was clearly in the thick of it with, you know, corporations and foreign, you know, extractive corporations, as was the NLD. And so, you know, you can have a kind of an analysis that it's just about different factions trying to increase their stake, their slice of the pie. But ultimately, I don't think it breaks down that neatly or that simply. It's not a simple class or class analysis. It's a multifactorial system that's putting pressure on different forces. And ultimately, you know, for the current moment, the military has the upper hand. Whether that will continue to be the case is unknown.
Do you know anything about the ground troops? So who are the actual troops? Are they partly from the ethnic minorities or not?
So a lot of them have been conscripted from the Bama majority, but there are ethnic minorities in the military, and some of them have defected and some of them have refused. And so it's a very complex situation. The thing that I can tell you is that the current troops that are putting down the protests belong to the LID, the Light Infantry Divisions. And these are divisions that have been actively involved in a counterinsurgency in the ethnic minority areas, which is to say essentially that they have been involved in ethnic cleansing and genocide. And when you send in counterinsurgency troops, literally pull them out of battle to put down protesters, you know, you can imagine the kind of results you're going to get. These are battle-hardened troops that are used to you know, slaughtering people by the dozens, which is what they've been doing even prior to these protests. This has been ongoing. And of course, this is not to say that any of this is justifiable by any means, but this slaughter, this level of slaughter has been ongoing in Myanmar. And that's why I think it's important to foreground our discussion in the understanding of this massive civil war and ethnic cleansing that has been ongoing for the past decades.
Thank you. Let's move on. Ann Lewis, and then we have John Walsh and Mehmet, and then we need more people to put their hands up. So Ann, you go ahead.
Sure. So I have a question more about, is there any kind of organization of workers in terms of the people that are working in the mines or those kinds of labor union structures? Is there any of that? And also, is there any kind of organization that cuts across somewhat? You showed a slide of rural people in protest. Is there any kind of organization of those people that cuts across ethnic lines?
You know, I think there's an attempt to make that right now. And the key, you know, organization is, you know, this shadow government, which is largely led by the NLD, but is trying to build bridges with the rest of the ethnic organizations. There's also, you know, resistance among civil servants. You know, there's resistance within, for example, medical workers. There's resistance within smaller trade groupings, such as transportation. So these things exist. But, you know, once again, it's a very different situation, simply because of the heterogeneity of all the groups involved. As I said, 135 distinct ethnic groups. possibly over 150, and then split up into multiple armed factions with different interests. This makes the kind of, the coordinated resistance, I think it is much more complex than it seems. And at the current moment, the NLD's proxy shadow or parallel government is trying to create some kind of inter-ethnic coalition against the military. There's also a kind of, not simply a class line, but there's also an age difference. So the younger generation seems to be much more aligned across cultural and ethnic relations. They're building solidarity across that. So they seem to be much more involved. Older ethnic organizations are much more conservative, and they're either stepping back and having a wait and see attitude. Some of them have actually joined the military. After the coup happened, the Union Election Committee invited 91 political parties to a meeting, and it annulled the election in November, and 53 joined the military. So that gives you a sense of what the political landscape is like. 38 refused to join the military, but 53 did. And then the rest of them kind of maintained a wait and see attitude. In Rakhine State, the Arakan army has aligned with the NLD. And that's important because the Arakan army is one of the largest armed ethnic organizations. And we saw this early, we saw the signaling of this because the first day the coup happened, remember, the Burmese military was engaged in massive ethnic slaughter in Rakhine State. And then the day the coup happened, the internet had been shut down for 2 years in Rakhine State. And right after the coup, the military turned the internet back up and allowed the Rakhine State people to broadcast. So that gives you a sense that they have a sense of who their potential allies are, or at least who the enemies of their enemies are. And so all this is to say is that the CRPH, this is the shadow government, they are calling for a federal army of all the Burmese and all the ethnic armed groups to defeat the military. They're calling for armed revolution. And they removed all the armed ethnic organizations from as terrorist organizations. But we have to know that individuals from the Rakhine State, from the Chin, the Kachin, the Karen, and the Mon ethnic communities have accepted positions in the coup regime. So all of this is to say is that there are members of the elite and the business class that are waiting, standing by. You can see that the foreign powers are both trying to agitate, but also waiting to see who comes out ahead. And then in the meantime, there is an attempt to create solidarity and unity by the CRPH, the kind of shadow government in exile. But that itself looks to be fractured. And so far, the only success, real success that they've had is with Shan State, Kachin, and the Karen, and among youth.
Okay. Well, thank you. And we'll move forward. Our list, next on the list is John Walsh, and then Mehmet, and then Richard W. And if you want to get on the list, raise your hand. So go ahead, John. Are you there, John? Your iPad is. Well, let's move forward. We'll put you back on the list and move forward to Mehmet.
Hi. Thank you very much for a very informative session and presentation. I'm not going to pretend that I absorbed everything. I will, like Gene, have to watch the recording maybe several times to understand. I would like to see if you have any articles, recent articles, that attempt to explain what's going on. I would really appreciate if you can recommend some of those so that, you know, there's a reading that goes with this to complete the understanding of what's going on there. Again, thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you. I'll enter it into the chat, some things that people can read.
Okay, well, thank you. And we'll move forward. Is John back with us? No. So we'll move to Richard W. and we can add more people who want to be added to this chat. So raise your hand. Richard, go ahead.
Yeah, I'd like to third the as far as I'll need to go back over this as well. It was very, very good. I had no idea what was going on in Myanmar and you did a good job of explaining the history of it. I guess my question is this, is you briefly alluded to foreign military influences in Myanmar. I was wondering if you could elaborate on that. In particular, the CIA, the National Endowment for Democracy, the British. But I noticed in your presentation, there's a distinct lack of anything Chinese. Are there any Chinese foreign military activities in Myanmar? Thank you.
It's possible. I made a list of military supporters and arms supporters, and if you see that, I'll see if I can bring the slide back up for you. So certainly there are multiple parties that are involved. Now it's probably likely that the Chinese have relations with some of these armed ethnic organizations, both antagonistic and supportive. If you remember, in 1950, the Korean War broke out, but it's a kind of a simplistic understanding to think that that was simply a war that happened because North Korea invaded South Korea. It was a pincer movement that happened in two or three areas. On the Eastern Front, the US attempted to attack China from the Korean Peninsula. And on the Western Front, the US tried to attack China using Myanmar through Kuomintang proxies. And this was actually a very protracted war that lasted late into the 60s. Eventually, the CIA had to go in and airlift the KMT out of Myanmar. But the KMT, the Kuomintang, the Chinese nationalist fascists, were fighting a protracted war against China starting from 1950 onwards for over a decade. So again, the Chinese have been involved in that border dispute for a very long time. They have a 1,200-mile border along Yunnan province with Burma. So there's tremendous interaction, tremendous amounts of cross-border trade. There are probably arms that are being smuggled, as well as methamphetamine and other drugs that have been smuggled in from Burma, Myanmar, into China. So there's a region which is really kind of a complex no man's land. And also the other thing to understand, and once again, you're not going to get this if you think of this only from, by looking at maps, is a lot of the populations in Myanmar, especially along the western and northern border, are actually Chinese ethnicities. The Shan states have traditionally either been independent or aligned with China to different degrees. And many of the ethnic minorities, these are ethnic minorities that are considered part of China's officially recognized ethnic minorities, but they spread out into Myanmar as well. I mean, the borders do not respect the lines drawn on maps. So all of this is to say is that, yes, the US has been involved historically. The CIA has been involved in a very deep way historically. The Australian SAS, the French Foreign Legion, US Green Berets have also been involved with some of the ethnic militia. Most notably, the Karen state seems to have had the closest collaboration with Western militaries. And this has to do with its history. It was originally, for a period of about 60 years, it fought with the British against the Burmese. But the largest group that has intervened in Burma, we really have to understand this as the British. You know, the British waged war and then intervened and controlled and manipulated, most likely derailed the Panglong Agreement. They armed and instigated, supported the ethnic minority warfare. And this is, you know, part of the imperial pattern. Everywhere where the British have been, the legacy of that has been ethnic cleansing and armed warfare for decades after they leave. I mean, most notably, most recently in Hong Kong, where the British simply will not give up and continue to wage gray zone warfare. But certainly, let's think of all the other states, Palestine, India, Pakistan. We could spend the whole session just naming all the places where the British have used different ethnic groups, armed ethnic groups to wage war and to disrupt and to create a state of chaos. You know, Pepe Escobar, who's a very interesting thinker, argues that as the global empire collapses and, loses its ability to control, he argues that the strategy of the global imperial elite is just to fracture the world into a series of small warring states that he refers to as the Empire of Chaos. And as this happens, the Atlantic Empire will still control, key sectors. They'll control the financial sector, and they'll control the sea lanes, and they'll control major institutions and continue to extract rent from the rest of the world as the global south disintegrates into chaos and warring states. So, there's one argument that this is what they're planning rather than direct control. And I think there's an argument to say that, what we see in Syria, what we see in Libya, what we see in Ukraine, what we see in Myanmar might be heading along this direction. Certainly, I think the Middle East and North Africa are good examples of this strategy.
Hey, Gene, we have a question from John, who had his hand raised. His mic isn't working. Do you want me to go ahead and ask that now for him?
Can he get on now?
No, his mic is out, so I can ask it for him.
Oh, okay. Why don't you ask John's question?
This is from John Walsh. Has actually a two-part question. The first one is, what is the impact of this on the limb of the BRI, Belt and Road Initiative, that runs through Myanmar and provides a key outlet to the Indian Ocean? in short and long term? And the second one is, what should our posture be other than a basic anti-interventionism? Related to this, what are the US organizations like the NED, et cetera, up to now?
Okay, these are all really great questions. The first thing is, what is the impact of this on the limb of the Belt and Road Initiative that runs through Myanmar, the CMEC? Well, the first thing we can note is that it's disrupted. It's disrupted it. There are currently pipelines that go through Rakhine State and Myanmar and then travel through to Yunnan. So these are very, very important pipelines. Currently, the threat is that among the Tea Party, the Milk Tea Alliance, which is like the, you know, it's like an Asian Tea Party, is that they're threatening to destroy the pipelines because they want to lay the blame for the coup on China, which is not correct. But they want to see if there's a way to lay blame on China and to use it to disrupt the pipelines. There's also the plans to construct a special economic zone near the port. And there was ongoing construction to, you know, deepen the port so that it could be a full deep sea water port. Those have hit roadblocks because of all of this disruption right now. As I mentioned, last year, 33 agreements were signed with the NLD to do Belt and Road Initiative projects. And remember, the Belt and Road, you know, there's a mythology that the Belt and Road is this kind of Chinese extractivist imperialism laden with debt traps. But the studies actually don't show that to be true. About 40% of Belt and Road projects are about electrification to communities that don't have them. And another 30 are about building road and rail infrastructure. Of course, there's a kind of a transportation logistic aspect, which is important for Myanmar because it allows goods to be shipped through Myanmar to China, bypassing the Straits of Malacca and the South China Sea. That's the key issue. But the larger picture of the Belt and Road is also, it's a collaborative kind of developmental and poverty alleviation, similar to the kind of work that China has done inside its own borders. So there has been an impact to the Belt and Road. We'll see what happens. The contracts were signed with the NLD, not with the military. So we'll see if the military will decide to come along and make nice with the Chinese, sign their own agreements, or whether they will actually, step back from the wings, go back into the wings, and return the country to a civilian power within a year, which is what they have promised. But the impacts are ongoing, and so then this raises the stakes. And certainly this is where the geostrategic and the geopolitical aspects are involved. And this is why the US has a thick hand, as well as the Milk Tea Alliance. So what is the NED up to now? It was funding millions of dollars worth of civil society trainings and organizations, not just in among the Burmese majority, but actually in all of the ethnic minority states. They were training and doing quote unquote human rights education, electoral reform, all of these kinds of things that are a kind of, it's the construction of a parallel society and a parallel government to the existing government. This is the function of CSOs, civil society organizations in this modern world. They pick energetic, bright, and well-connected individuals, fund them so that they create parallel structures. And then eventually what these do is they undermine the existing structures of government, similar to the way in which the nonprofit industrial complex inside the United States itself functions like a parallel government, doing many of the functions that would ordinarily be done by government itself. They function as subcontractors for aspects of the government. But in other organizations, for example, inside the United Nations itself, CSOs have created multiple partnerships that have transformed the nature and the direction of the United Nations, essentially privatizing large parts of UN policy. And certainly they have been had this function in Myanmar. Certainly they had a very, very powerful function in Hong Kong. You saw that all the CSOs essentially erupted into anti-state actors during the Hong Kong color revolutions. So the NED is, you know, up to its gills in intervention. What is it doing exactly? That's hard to see. You can go onto the NED website and you see the actual funding. I think there are scores of projects that are being funded to the tune of millions right now. But what you have to understand about funding in general is it's never what you see on paper, which is what is happening. The relationship between a funder and the funded is always a series of backdoor channels and kind of tacit relationships that are actually much more important than the actual, you know, overt, you know, stated objectives and transfer. So there's probably a lot of strategizing going on. There is probably a lot of skill building going on. There's probably a lot of, you know, political base building going on right now. So the final question is, what should our posture be other than a basic anti-interventionism? And, you know, this is a question that's very hard to answer because on the one hand, there is a horrific tragedy that's going on. It's horrific. But at the same time, remember that this horrific tragedy has been ongoing. It has, you know, this level of slaughter has been happening, you know, fairly regularly in the countryside against the ethnic minorities. So what is our position? I think I'd like to just, you know, throw that question back to this group because it's not a simple answer. I think that assuming that the US or US intervention will be for the good certainly is a mistake because there's so many cynical actors involved. Certainly the actors that are trying to lay this onto China or the actors that are bloviating, around, you know, the virtues of the NLD, they're certainly misguided. They have a very kind of clear political agenda. But as critically thinking progressives and Marxists, I think the question is, what should the response of, you know, the critically informed be in this country? I think John points out the key issue is to prevent things from getting worse by the US. I think, you know, as the doctors say, first, do no harm. But beyond that, you know, what is the position? What is the posture? What are the actions? I think that's a really important discussion. And I'd actually like to open that up to the rest of the group, if that's okay with you, Gene.
Okay, well, first of all, let's move over to Keith, who is next, and then Gillen. Who's following that? And then I'll put myself on the stack and then we'll see if we have how much time we have. So Keith, go ahead.
Yes, well, three quick questions. One, what is the percentage of Burma that is ethnic majority? That's the first one. Second, have any of the neighbors of Burma shown that they have designs on territory within Burma? Because this sounds like it would be a great opportunity for them if they did. And third, just how viable is Burma? Because it sounds to me like Yugoslavia on steroids, the way it, from the description I'm getting. So just those three questions.
Yeah, Those are great questions. The majority Burman are 68% of the population, and it's a country of 55 million. So they're 68%. And then the next grouping is the Shan. The Shan are 9%, followed by the Karen, and then the Rakhine, the 4%, and the Mon, and then et cetera, it goes down from there. I think that it's probably more complex and volatile than Yugoslavia, simply because this ethnic war has been ongoing for such a long time. And because they have been, I mean, these are not, I mean, we're not talking about, you know, the, we're not talking about minor militias, you know, who brandish guns and wear masks and make poetic statements like, you know, that we've seen with certain other quote unquote ethnic groups. These are real militaries. These are real militaries. They have real armies. You can go online and you can see some of them training. I mean, this is serious military force that they're capable of exhibiting. They have, some of them have their own munitions factories. So they're self-sufficient in military force. And also in this current day and age with drones and powerful, you know, light weaponry, including guided missiles, shoulder launched guided missiles, they're capable of, you know, exacting tremendous pain, you know, against even more armed, powerful conventional militaries. So it is, it's a very complex situation. It risks becoming even more bloody, especially if these armed ethnic groups collaborate in some way to take up a coordinated armed struggle against the Burmese military. And there are armed ethnic groups that will align with the military. So I think it goes back to the larger question is, you know, what do we do here? You know, what is the best, what are the best actions of a concerned and conscientious, you know, progressive Marxist socialist position? I think that's a really important question.
Okay, we'll move forward to Gildan and Sandeep and then Jean, and then we will evaluate our situation we have until 12:30. When we will stop recording. So, Gillen.
Hi, KJ. Thank you very much for the presentation. For the question that you directed to address to the group earlier, my opinion is this Myanmar situation is pretty much China's effort to secure its border security attempting to resist the influence of the global powers, especially from US, and also securing its economic and commercial relationship with Myanmar so far. US and the other global powers 4 days ago tried to put pressure on China also on the Human Rights Council. But China and Russia departed from this human rights decision that that was taken on Myanmar. So my opinion is this is pretty much US and China war going on in Myanmar. Thank you so much.
I would agree with parts of that, and I would like to, you know, make that a little bit more precise. You know, the Chinese are not waging war against the Americans. The Americans, the US is encircling China. And starting 1950, it has seen Myanmar and that border with Yunnan as a real vulnerability for China, as well as Xinjiang, as well as Hong Kong, as well as Korea. If you look at, if you imagine a profile of a face, you can imagine that they're weak points along the face, the nose, the chin, the jaw, the throat, the back of the head. These are, you know, vulnerable points on the head. and they correspond to China. China has the largest number of borders with any other country, and some of those borders are very, very vulnerable. So the first one is Korea. Korea is like the bridge of the nose. It's the bridgehead onto the Asian continent, onto the Chinese continent from Japan and Korea. And Japan is one of the most powerful militaries in the world, it's the fifth most powerful military on the planet. So that is the nose. Then we have the chin, which is Hong Kong, and that is a core interest. And there's also, Hong Kong is like the jaw. The chin is really Taiwan, because Taiwan forms the center of the arc of the first island chain. There is the first island chain, which is what the US uses as a kind of unsinkable aircraft carrier to encircle China. And the closest point of that, about 18 miles away from China, is Taiwan. And Taiwan also guards the Taiwan Strait, which is the narrow strait or channel which all Chinese shipping and Chinese submarines will have to move through in order to break out into blue waters. So it really is the most dangerous. It's really the most dangerous part of that encirclement for China. And that's why China considers Taiwan to be its part of its core interest. It's not just that it's an unresolved civil war, which it is. Taiwan would have been liberated in 1950 if the US had not attacked it from Burma and North Korea, Burma and South Korea. But the key issue is that Taiwan is so close. And if the US were to start placing missiles, short-range missiles, short-range nuclear missiles, as they are currently doing right now, as they've literally appropriated money to do right now, if that were to happen, then it would make things just so much more dangerous. Okay. The third vulnerability, or the fourth vulnerability, is the throat. And the throat, or the choke point, is the South China Sea, as I pointed out. The South China Sea, and especially the Straits of Malacca, that is the windpipe of China, and the carotid artery. If the US can choke that off, China will have to tap out. Okay. And then the fifth vulnerability is the back of the head. It's really the rabbit blow. And that is the area of Xinjiang and also Tibet. And this is where the US has traditionally tried to attack and destabilize China from those regions. But specifically, the Belt and Road traverses Myanmar in order to bypass the South China Sea. There are other routes that are also trying to bypass the South China Sea, but Myanmar, the CMEC, is the most immediate route that bypasses that. Now, remember, China had agreements with the civilian government, the NLD, to do all their Belt and Road construction. 33 agreements were signed last year. Xi Jinping went and met with Aung San Suu Kyi and the NLD last year, big photo ops. So they clearly were in very, very tight with the NLD. There is no reason, there is absolutely no reason why the Chinese would have instituted a coup with the military and put themselves in this very uncertain situation when they already had the situation that they wanted with the NLD. But that said, I agree with you, there are powerful geopolitical factors involved. For the US standpoint, it's a matter of disrupting the Belt and Road and encircling China from along a 1200 mile border along its west. And for the Chinese standpoint, it's a matter of survival. This is their escape through this encirclement. And so that's one of the reasons why Myanmar is so important from a geopolitical standpoint.
Okay, next we have Sandeep and then Jean, and we have about 15 minutes left, so we'll have to negotiate with maybe Alan to see if we can squeeze a few more minutes of recording or not. So let's go to Sandeep next. Sandeep.
Yeah, this has been such a great presentation, and your mastery of the topic, and I really appreciate that. I've learned so much during your presentation, and I do take your points regarding US encirclement of China, I think it's a very serious thing, and it's a real thing, and it's a real threat to China. I mean, I had two or three sort of follow-up questions along those lines. One is, do you think that there could ever be a kind of armed, you know, any kind of armed conflict, or, you know, even blocking of Straits of Malacca or other places, given the fact that US and Chinese economy are so integrated, and US and Chinese supply chains are so integrated at this point in time? And also, China plus Russia militarily as a bloc is at par with US in military terms, and probably would be ahead of US in economic terms in another 5 to 10 years. So, I mean, that was my first question. Second, you've been sort of looking at Belt and Road Initiative primarily as a defensive move by China to prevent its encirclement. But I think there is another element, which is China has built as a part of its own development massive capacity that it is now helping other countries to build their industrial capacities. You know, so it's not just a defensive thing. It's also, in a sense, a more forward-looking positive step by China to use its industrial capacity to industrialize other parts of global South. And so I would not just look at, there are compromises here that China is making. You know, I mean, I would love to see China support more progressive forces in Pakistan and Burma, but China pretty much does business with whoever is in power. And, you know, it is a non-interventionist party, you know, policy. It does business with whoever is in power. And if you could comment on that. And my third question was, how do you see US and Chinese confrontation reflecting on, you know, polarization in Asia as a whole? I mean, is Asia going to go through what Europe went through with, you know, polarization? As capitalism grows in Asia, would it go through what Europe went through with First World War and Second World War? Or would Asia be able to jump those stages and come up with some kind of a federation like Eurozone is today? And in what stages do you think Asia will evolve? Because Asia is clearly becoming the economic center of the world now. And if you look at South Korea, Japan, China, Taiwan put together, not just economically, but even technologically, they are more advanced of US at this point in time. So how do you think, you know, this rivalry would sort of reflect in Asia in the coming decades?
You know, these are huge questions. It's so important. And I don't know that I can give full justice to them, but just you're asking these questions is so important. The first thing I think we have to understand is there's a transition, and it's really a tectonic shift from unipolarity to multipolarity. Starting in the post-World War II era, but really even designed before then, the US had planned for global unipolar hegemony. And this was validated after the fall of the Soviet Union, and starting 1992, they drafted this thing called the Defense Planning Guidance Document, which was an explicit plan to dominate the planet, to have the US dominate the planet. It was going to be the boss of the entire planet, and it would not brook any challenges to its hegemony. And China, starting 1992, was explicitly named as a potential challenger. This defense planning guidance document was so embarrassing that when it was leaked, the Pentagon and the government had to disavow it immediately, but then it was recycled and refurbished in the 1997 Project for a New American Century. So the PNAC essentially was a recycling of this theory of, you know, this doctrine of global hegemony, unipolarity at all costs. This became part of the 2002 Bush Doctrine. It was essentially the Bush Doctrine. And the Bush Doctrine was carried over in the Obama Doctrine. There's very little difference between the two. And then it took on a neo-mercantile flavor with Trump. And then it's recovered its full kind of, theory of hegemony with the Biden administration. That said, a lot has changed since then. As you point out, this tremendous integration between the two economies, which Trump tried to decouple. Now, that decoupling is extraordinarily foolish, and it points to the lack of intelligence of Trump, because, you know, Trump's background is a real estate businessman. And in real estate, there really isn't much of a supply chain. If you're looking at land, there is no supply chain. If you're looking at a building, you're looking at maybe between 20 and 200 different components. But if you look at, for example, something everyday like a car has 30,000 different components that go into it. And those supply parts are, come from all over the world. So that supply chain is incredibly complex. And the Trump administration tried to retrench itself into this very kind of simplistic neo-mercantilist thinking, and they thought they could decouple. But that has been very difficult. It's been much harder. But they are still trying this, and they want to do this at the very least in key technologies, primarily in advanced technology and AI and 5G and things like that. They essentially want to destroy the Chinese capacity, and they want to isolate the Chinese from the global economy. In another sense, this is what the Trans-Pacific Partnership was about. The TPP was a plan to isolate and to freeze China out from the global economy. Trump, in his own goal, scoring against himself, did the rest of the world a favor by scuttling it, because he thought he could come up with something better. But the fact is that you are absolutely correct. There's a way in which the two economies are deeply interconnected. And then there's a way in which the US is actively trying to decouple them. And that situation is complex, but it's always undergirded by geostrategic considerations. And the key geostrategic consideration is that we are moving from a world of unipolarity into multipolarity. That is, for the first time in decades, probably since the 1960s, there is a real movement and an alternative for the global South, that they don't have to fall into lockstep and become subservient to the neoliberal global order, and that China is offering a model of development which is unusual, because prior to China's development, all notions of development were considered to be capitalist and Western. To develop, you had to become Western, and you had to become capitalist, and you had to become part of the neoliberal system. This was the whole notion of there is no alternative and the end of history. China has shown that the end of history was actually a dead end, and that there are multiple alternatives. And this is the threat that China poses to the Atlanticist neoliberal imperial West, that it is the example or the threat of an alternative. And for the first time, it's not a small state like Cuba or any of the smaller socialist state. It is actually a global power. This is why the United States feels that it has to take it down. This is why it's escalating to war in the most visible manner, but most clearly and obviously in information warfare. And this information warfare against China is also the reason why we're seeing the attacks on Asians in the streets, because when you have that level of wholesale policy hate mongering, it's going to trickle down into retail individual attacks, both over there and over here. If you prepare for war over there, you're also going to get attacks over here. So that's the larger context. But again, as you said, Sandeep, the alliances that are happening are not just happening between Russia and China, which is very, very important. But I remind you, just a few days ago, China signed a 25-year strategic cooperation agreement with Iran. That essentially means that Iran cannot be sanctioned, and that China will have another very, very powerful ally in the Middle East. So we're already seeing this fracturing of this unipolar global hegemon. And wiser heads at the Council for Foreign Relations and Foreign Policy have pointed this out. They say the US really needs to kind of dial down its rhetoric and have a little bit more humility and essentially accept the fact that multipolarity is the order of the day. But clearly Biden administration is not taking that, Blinken is not taking that, Kurt Campbell is not accepting that, and they're still escalating to war. Now, the final question you asked, or the first question you asked is war even conceivable? And could it be won? But as I point out, the way that the United States has war gained its confrontation out with China has been a first that it doesn't need to win a war, it just has to have a war. If the war happens in the South China Sea, then that disrupts trade. The way a single tanker can disrupt the Suez Canal. Imagine if you have a shooting war where $5.3 trillion worth of goods travel through, or 70% of your oil travels through, then that is going to have a huge impact on your economy. But more than that, the current Biden administration is really staffed with CNAS. CNAS is the Center for American Security. And CNAS is really the kind of rhyming cognate of PNAC, the Project for a New American Century. They're essentially the neocons. They're the neocons on steroids. And they have war gamed up an extensive plan of war with China. It's very, very specific. It's very, very concrete. And it involves what they call the third offset. If we go back to our history, remember, the first offset was against the Soviet Union. And it was the idea that with massive power, with sheer mass, you could destroy the Soviet Union. Well, the Soviet Union responded by creating its own massive power, its own nuclear forces. So then they came up with what was called the second offset. The second offset was precision. The idea that if you had enough precision, you could wipe out Soviet forces, you know, through guided missiles, cruise missiles, etc., and neutralize them, you know, within hours. This is what we saw most obviously in Desert Storm. But this was, the second offset was developed against the Soviet Union. And the Soviet Union also developed its own counter strategies as well. Now the US is facing off against China, and CNAS is developing what they call the third offset. What is the third offset? Well, it's several things. One is dispersion and swarming. So China has the capacity to defend its perimeter through these incredibly powerful long distance guided missiles. And the US strategy has to do, the third offset has to do with automated warfare. So we're talking about AI driven bots that conduct the warfare. We're talking about swarming warfare. We're talking about subsurface warfare, because the Chinese can attack anything and defend anything that comes to them on the surface. So the Chinese can, so the US counter strategy is to develop subsurface warfare that is probably also automated and swarming, okay? And then the fourth is to develop, is to generate an entire new generation of tactical nuclear weapons. And remember, the US has a first strike policy. US declared nuclear posture is that if it is attacked by another power and it feels that this has led to a strategic disadvantage or could lead to a strategic disadvantage, for example, let's say China were to attack one of the US's radar installations, the THAAD radar installations, then the US could see that as a strategic attack and retaliate with nuclear weapons. So that is already in the works, but even more is the fact that the US has created an entire generation of small nukes, tactical nuclear weapons that it doesn't even consider to be nuclear weapons. And these are, you know, within the 5 to 20 to 50 kiloton range. They are currently in the process, if I'm not mistaken, of arming them on cruise missiles and placing them all around China's periphery. This is the reason why the US pulled out of the intermediate IND, Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty. And that was planned in the early 2000s as they were starting to generate, strategies against China. So all this is to say is that it sounds absurd and unwinnable, but actually, the US is a slow learner when it comes to war. And despite having lost every single war, since in the last five decades, it still believes that it can win. And then there's another, group that are actually millenarian Christians that don't care. And they would rather see, the end of the world rather than the end of capitalism and the end of white supremacy.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Whoa. Excellent. I agree. And let me check with our tech man, Alan. Do we have time for a little more, or we're
past 12:30. Why don't you go ahead and ask your question, and then we'll switch over to open mic.
Oh, okay. Well, I agree with everything. Let me just make a couple little comments. First of all, I'm impressed with the work of Kishore Madhubani, the fellow from Singapore, and his new book is "The West Has Lost It." But they don't know it yet. And I think that kind of sums up our situation in a very real sense, China is, in a sense, can't really be attacked by the Soviet Union, by United States. And it just hasn't realized that yet. But, my own views on this go back to, I'm a product of the Vietnam War period, and that's how I formulated my ideas. And we understood back then that the Vietnam War was a war of imperialism against a socialist Vietnam. And that has continued basically since then. And, it just has evolved and deepened since then with our attacks on the Middle East and so on. But, and I think about, in some ways, I'm like an American exceptionalist. I think America is the root of all evil in the world. But I realize it's not quite all evil. And I resonate with what Dr. King said, that, United States, the biggest purveyor of violence is our own government. And that's true of human rights abuses and so many other things. But his solution, again, was we need a radical revolution of values. And basically, being a socialist, Dr. King viewed that we need socialist values rather than capitalist values. So I hope he will respond or elaborate on that point, and then we can switch to unmonitored discussion and end our recording.
Gene, I think that your point is well taken. And if for no other reason than the sheer force and the power that the United States exerts on the rest of the world, if that were a force for good, simply the lack of understanding could cause extraordinary harm. But we know that that's not the case, simply because of the geopolitical design, going back to, the early 20th century, that there has been a very deliberate and violent attempt to control the world. Inside that context, we have to think of, the forces of global capitalism, especially financialized capitalism, especially the way in which capitalism in the West has turned to a purely kind of rentier economy. The US does not have, the kind of infrastructure. It doesn't build the kind of infrastructure and economy that's necessary to sustain, a reasonable, rational form of society. What it does is it concentrates force and power in its IP and extractive and rentier dimensions, and then this is reinforced and upheld by force of arms across the rest of the world. So that's the current situation that we're in. But you know, the other element of the exceptionalism that I think is important for us to understand, especially among the so-called progressive left, is what is called, what I refer to as a kind of inverted exceptionalism. So I think on sectors of the left, people are willing to agree that the US is not the shining hill, shining city on the hill, but they still like to argue that the US is no worse than any other state, and that nobody, we may not be the worst, we may not be the best, but nobody can be better than us. And so this is the kind of inverted exceptionalism that you see, where they kind of try and stake out, you know, the lower dimensions and saying, you know, China, you know, China is just yet another imperialist state, or it is, you know, like the United States. Of course, you know, it's never waged a war of aggression against another country, taken slaves, colonized other countries, indulged in primitive accumulation across the world. It doesn't have colonies or military bases around the world, except for one in Africa, which even Japan has, you know, right next door. But the whole point is that there's a kind of inverted exceptionalism that I see in the quote unquote progressive left. And it's essentially the argument that we don't support the United States, although we benefit from the kind of imperial rent that it confers on us in our lives and in our authority and in our cultural power. But we have to condemn China as well, because they are both you know, imperial states. They're both colonizing the world. And that's kind of a absurdity beyond conception. But I still see that played out among, you know, various factors of the Western left, certainly those that do not have a good critical understanding. And of course, those that are aligned with, you know, the Jacobin magazine and other, you know, very regressive and misguided political alliances.
So those are very good last words, and we will stop it there. I think, Alan, we will end the recording and go to an unmonitored, unrecorded session in which people can speak freely. And Alan, do you have anything to say on this, or?
No, just... I'll stop it right now, and we'll open up. Everybody can unmute themselves, no moderation. So whatever comments you have for discussion, go right ahead.
But if people go too far off the, you know, start talking about their pet, their puppies and things like that, we will.
Institute for the Critical Study of Society at the Niebuhr-Proctor Marxist Library receives no corporate funding, nor do we have any paid staff. We rely on the support of working class folks that share our commitment to the socialist legacy of Karl Marx. We continue to need funds to meet necessary expenses. Since we can no longer pass the hat at our in-person forums, please send contributions to our treasurer, either online via PayPal or by check. The PayPal ID is ICSS Sunday, S-U-N-D-A-Y, at yahoo.com. And the name is Richard Fallenbaum. And checks may be made out to Richard Fallenbaum and sent to him at 1225 Nielsen Street, Berkeley, California, 94706. Fallenbaum is spelled F-A-L-L-E-N-B-A-U-M. To donate directly to the Marxist Library, send a check to the Niebuhr-Proctor Marxist Library at 6501 Telegraph Avenue, Oakland, California, 94609 or directly or donate online at www.paypal.me/npml. For information, write to npml@marxistlibr.org. And the website is marxistlibr.org.